Please stand for the reading of God's holy word. And our scripture reading this morning comes from Genesis chapter 32, and I will be reading verses 22 through 32 from the New King James Version. If everyone is there, would you please say amen?
Amen.
And he arose that night and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 sons, and crossed over the ford of Jabbok. He took them, sent them over the brook, and sent over what he had. Then Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Now when he saw that he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, "Let me go, for the day breaks." But he said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he had said to him, "What is your name?" He said, "Jacob." And he said, "Your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel. For you have struggled with God and men and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked, saying, "Tell me your name, I pray." And he said, "Why is it that you ask about my name?" And he blessed him there. And Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, "For I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved." Just as he crossed over Peniel, the sun rose on him, and he limped on his hip. Therefore, to this day, the children of Israel do not eat the muscle that shrank, which is on the hip socket, because he touched the socket of Jacob's hip in the muscle that shrank. So then faith cometh by hearing.
Hearing by the word of God.
You may be seated. My subject for this morning is prevailing prayer. Prayer is talking and listening to God. It's intimate fellowship with God. But prevailing prayer is that prayer that has become strong and mighty. Prevailing prayer is conquering prayer. It's that kind of prayer that's triumphant, that kind of prayer that succeeds, that kind of prayer that perseveres. And so prayer is the answer. No matter what the problem may be, whatever the problem, prayer is the first answer to solving the problem. Prayer is the first thing you should do. And prayer will either help in solving the problem, or prayer will strengthen you to walk through the problem. And sometimes the problems confronting you are large and they seem insurmountable and overwhelming. Problems with your husband, wife, or children. Problems with your boss or your employee. Problems with friends, relatives, neighbors, co-workers, or classmates, and problems with finances. And far too often, the problems result in separation, divorce, alienation, ruptured friendships, and bad business deals. And the need is for peace, forgiveness, and reconciliation. But far too often, reconciliation seems impossible. There just seems to be no way to be reconciled. But there is a way. Prayer. Prayer is the answer. Prevailing prayer. Prayer that wrestles and prevails with God. And in this passage of scripture today is the picture of Jacob facing a crisis, and the situation seemed hopeless. Jacob was in desperate agony. He was gripped by a spirit of fear and suffering, and it was almost unbearable. And he knew that there was only one person who could help him: God. So Jacob went to the Lord in prayer. And he prayed and he prayed and he prayed. And he struggled in prayer, weeping and crying and sobbing. Jacob was wrestling and agonizing in prayer. Jacob felt that if God didn't help him, he would die. And so he refused to quit praying until God did help. Jacob refused to leave God's presence. He refused to let God go until God met his need. And God did. Jacob prayed and prayed until he prevailed. He prayed until his prayer was answered. But But Jacob also learned the great lesson of prevailing prayer, the kind of prayer that triumphs and stirs God to answer and meet your need. And what a lesson this is for believers. How many of your desperate needs would be met, clearly met, unquestionably met, if you would just learn prevailing prayer? If you would just learn to pray, praying until you prevail with God, praying until you conquer, praying until you are triumphant, praying until your prayer is answered. How many of you would pray until you've stirred God to answer and meet your need? Verses 22 to 24 says, and he rose that night and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 sons, and crossed over the ford of Jabbok. He took them, sent them over the brook, and sent over what he had. Then Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Jacob got alone to pray. And apparently he had gone to bed, but he was unable to sleep because of the great fear and distress he was feeling. And feeling gripped by fear and distress, he was desperate. And the fear and distress was almost unbearable. And so again, Jacob knew that there was only one person who could help him, God. Jacob knew that if he had to be alone to seek God's face, he knew that he had to be alone to seek God's face for strength and help. And so he got up and sent his family and all his possessions on across the ford of the river Jabbok. Mark chapter 6 verse 46 says, and when he had sent them away, he departed to the mountain to pray. Jacob remained behind, all alone to pray without any distractions or demands from family members or workers. And everything was still and quiet and hushed. And Jacob stood there all alone under the stars of the night with no one present except him and God. And if you think about it, crises after crises attacks us during our life. And some of those crises are beyond our help. And a crisis is a disaster, a catastrophe, an emergency, a calamity, a predicament. It's a turning point in your life. It's a defining point in your life. We just face crises after crises. Crises such as death and accidents and diseases. Crises such as suffering, bankruptcy, and all the inevitable sufferings and pain brought on by our living in a corrupt and sinful world. But when a crisis does strike, prayer is our first answer. Or should I say, prayer should be our first answer. Prayer should be the very first thing we do. But to pray, we must get alone with God, because when we're surrounded by people, we can't concentrate in prayer because people and duties distract us. And God is just like our loved ones. He wants our full attention. He wants us alone so we can concentrate fully on Him and our need. And this is especially true when we face those great crises in life. And I'm in a crisis right now. But I went to God in prayer and I asked Him what He wanted me to do. And God just wants me to draw closer to Him, to be dependent upon Him, to seek Him. And just for the record, God doesn't waste anything, no matter what the crisis is. The question is, do you draw closer to God in the crisis, or do you turn away from God in the crisis? Because what God wants is for us to get alone with Him so He can use the crisis to draw us closer to Him. God wants us to draw closer to Him so that He can take better care of us and make us stronger. God wants us to get alone with Him in prayer so He can eventually take us home to the promised land of heaven. But in those times of need, we must get alone with God in prayer. We must get alone to seek God's help. If you really want to fellowship with God, you must get alone with God and pray. But if you're that self-sufficient person, you don't pray. If you're that self-satisfied person, you won't pray. And if you're that self-righteous person, you can't pray. What I want you to get is that not a one of us, not you or me, will ever be greater than our prayer life. After Jacob took his family over to the other side and he sent over all his possessions, verse 24 says, Then Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Jacob was taught by God, taught that God wrestles with men in prayer. With deep agony, anguish, pain, torture, and suffering of his soul, Jacob began to pour out his soul to God, sharing his fear and his distress. Jacob shared his misery and agony with God. He sensed that God was right there with him, that God was ever so near, but God wasn't answering Jacob's prayer. God wasn't removing his fear and distress, and God wasn't giving him the assurance of deliverance he wanted. But why? Why wouldn't God deliver Jacob? And there was only one reason. God's word says that he always answers prayer except for one thing: sin. Psalm 66:18 says, "If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear." Iniquity is a lifestyle of sin. And Jacob had sin in his life. Jacob had something in his life that he was refusing to give up, something that he still wanted to hang on to. And as long as Jacob held on to it, God couldn't answer his prayer. God couldn't deliver him from his fear and distress. And Hosea 12 verse 4 says, "Yes, he struggled with the angel and prevailed. He wept and sought favor from him. He found him in Bethel, and there he spoke to us." Hosea says that Jacob was weeping, and that he was probably lying prostrate on the ground, flat on the ground, weeping and crying out to God for help. All the while, he was sensing a deep, intense conflict within his soul, a conflict between the sin he was holding on to and God's will for him to get rid of. The conflict with Jacob's soul was raging between him and God until he thought he would burst, and the picture was bound to be dramatic. And as God's servants, I think we can testify about our own prayer experiences when we're facing a crisis. And just for the record, conflict within your soul is the greatest indicator that you're outside the will of God. And if you're honest, you're probably like Jacob, because Jacob wept and wept. He cried and cried for God to help him until he couldn't even speak. Have you ever cried so hard that you just couldn't talk anymore? Well, the only thing Jacob could speak through his sobbing was the very name of God himself. And so he cried, "Oh God, oh God, oh God." On and on Jacob sobbed, and then it happened. Scripture says that a man began to wrestle with Jacob while he was lying there on the ground. But who was the man? And Hosea 12 and 4 says that it was the angel. And Jacob said in verse 30 that it was God himself. This means that the man was the angel of the Lord. But who was the angel of the Lord? And he was probably a very special angel that was sent to Jacob as the very representative of God himself. An angel sent by God himself with the very authority of God, who could speak for God. He was probably the second person of the Trinity, the Lord Jesus Christ, who made a very special appearance to help Jacob. And the second person of the Trinity is what's called a pre-incarnate appearance of Jesus Christ on earth, because Jesus appeared to Jacob in the Old Testament. The Lord Jesus Christ was making a special appearance on earth to help Jacob. And Jacob himself was praying that it was God. And this would suggest that the angel of the Lord, the man Jesus who wrestled and wrestled with Jacob, and he wrestled with Jacob all night long, the angel of the Lord refused to leave Jacob alone until Jacob dealt with the sin in his life. The point to see is this: God was teaching Jacob that he, God himself, wrestles with people, and he wrestles with us over the sin in our lives. And so it isn't only that we wrestle with God in prayer. God himself wrestles with us in prayer. God stays after us. He wrestles with us, and he refuses to let us go until we get rid of the sin in our lives. God can't answer our prayers and deliver us until we empty ourselves of all sin. Not some sin, but all sin. And so God wrestles with us, and he wrestles with us until we are willing to confess our sin and turn from our sin. Then and only then can he hear and deliver us from our trouble. Remember, Jacob stayed behind by himself, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. Verse 25 says, "Now when he saw that he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him." When the man saw that he couldn't get the best of Jacob, as they wrestled, he deliberately threw Jacob's hip out of joint. Jacob was taught that he was a cripple, and that without God, he was helpless and powerless, and that he was totally dependent upon God for deliverance and strength in life. And the point speaks for itself. And to repeat it, Jacob had learned that without God, he was crippled, helpless, and powerless in life, and so are we. Jacob had to learn that he was totally dependent upon God for deliverance and strength in life, because Jacob had never learned this truth. This was the sin in Jacob's life, the sin that he just refused to let go of. Throughout his life, Jacob had been independent and self-sufficient. Throughout his life, he had been self-confident. Throughout his life, Jacob had been capable of handling matters himself. He was resourceful, self-motivated, and very responsible. From his earliest years, he had worked hard looking after the business affairs of his father and then of his uncle Laban. Jacob had plowed his own way through life, and God had blessed him with both success and wealth. But Jacob was apparently a man's man, physically, materially, and in business. And in his mind, he and God made a great team. But as long as God continued to help him, he could march on through life, accomplishing more and more for God. But notice what Jacob's attitude was saying about God. Jacob was saying that God was needed only as an addition to his life, only as a tack on, only when an emergency arose, only when things got out of control. Jacob had never learned that life is dependent upon God and God alone. Jacob had never learned that apart from God, there is no strength and deliverance. And Jacob needed the kind of strength and deliverance that lasted forever. The kind of strength and deliverance that carries you into the promised land of heaven. The kind of strength and deliverance that carries you into the very presence of God himself, where you live and serve God forever. But Jacob had never learned to trust God, not day by day or step by step. Jacob had never learned that God and God alone could handle the great crises of life. Thus, Jacob desperately needed to learn that he was totally dependent upon God, and without God, he was crippled, helpless, and powerless. And God taught this to Jacob by touching the socket of his hip and dislocating it. But why would God do this? Why would God cripple a man? And God did this because God doesn't pretend and play games with us. And you may pretend and play games with God, but God doesn't pretend and play games with you. And Jacob's task on this earth was so important that he had to walk with God day by day, not just when some crisis arose, not just when there was some disaster or some emergency in his life. And so God gave Jacob a permanent disability, a disability that would always remind him of this great truth, that he was totally dependent upon God, and without God, he was crippled, hopeless, helpless, and powerless. Never again would Jacob be able to work hard. Never again would Jacob be able to trust the arm of his flesh for success. Never again would Jacob be able to stand up against men and fight and win. Never again would Jacob be able to face the world and its dangers in the strength of his flesh. Jacob was crippled. Without God, he was helpless and powerless. Thus, once and for all, Jacob was totally dependent upon God. But here's the question. Have you ever been crippled in life? Have you ever been brought down, brought low? Have you ever been helpless and powerless? a crisis, a predicament, a crunch where no one, not even a group of people, not even your closest friend could help you? Well, this is what the terrible crises in life are like for all of us.
Amen.
God has structured the very universe, and he structured it like this so that we will know that without him in our life, we are crippled, helpless, and powerless. And God wants us to know that he and he alone can help us, and that he and he alone will help us. But we have to acknowledge our dependence on him. We have to seek his face in prevailing prayer, conquering prayer, the kind of prayer that's triumphant, the kind of prayer that succeeds, the kind of prayer that God answers. And so the answer is prayer. Prevailing prayer. Proverbs 3:5 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. Don't try to make sense of what God is doing. The point I want you to see is that God does wrestle with us. Jacob was wrestling with God in prayer, but God was also wrestling with Jacob throughout the experience. And two significant points need to be noticed about God's part in the wrestling experience. Point number one, God was working and wrestling with Jacob to get Jacob to subject his will and sinful nature to God. God was leading Jacob to commit his life totally to God. He was leading Jacob to give more and more of himself to God. And God is forever wrestling and working with you to get you to subject your will to his will. And God works and wrestles with you in what may be called special times or dramatic times. There are times in your life when your need is so desperate that you need to get all alone with God and pour your soul out to him. And God's purpose in these times is to cause a great leap forward in the surrendering of your will to God. The unfortunate fact is that so many professing believers don't take the time to get alone with God, even when their need is desperate, at least not for an extended period of time, not long enough to receive answers from God. And these experiences may be called spiritual crises or special manifestations of the Spirit of God or special infillings of the Spirit of God. Point number two, Jacob's crippling, his limp, was to be a reminder of his inadequacy and that he always needed to trust God for deliverance because he was incapable of delivering himself. The person who really wants to know God's will take time to get alone with God. You will actually wrestle with God in prevailing prayer. And when you do, you're the person who will learn two ultimate truths. You will learn that in the final analysis, you're ultimately dependent upon God both here on earth and in death. And you will learn that you can't face the world and its dangers in the strength of the flesh only. Because the flesh will eventually be struck down by accident, disease, age, or death. Verse 26 says, and he said, let me go for the day breaks. But he said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. Prevailing prayer. Jacob was taught that he could wrestle with God and prevail, that he could demand God's blessing. And guess what? So can we. And so Jacob just refused to let God go. And God didn't use his supernatural strength to get away. Now, God could have. He could have used his supernatural strength, but he didn't. He didn't choose to overcome Jacob. On the contrary, God wanted to arouse Jacob to cling to him, to cry out to him. God wanted Jacob to beg for the blessing more and more. But what was the blessing that Jacob so desperately wanted? And he certainly wanted to be saved and delivered from Esau's threat to kill him. But Jacob was returning to the promised land because God had called him to return. This was the main blessing Jacob was talking about, the promised blessing of God, the blessing of inheriting the promised land, and the blessing of bearing the promised seed, both the nations of people and the very special seed of the promised Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. The point is this. Jacob had been wrestling in prayer with God all night, and he just wasn't going to let God go until God blessed him. And this was the very lesson that God wanted to teach Jacob, that he could wrestle with God and prevail, that he could demand God's blessings. And so the lesson is clear. We must wrestle with God, and we must keep on wrestling with God until we prevail. We must demand God's blessings. We must demand his deliverance and the hope of the promised land of heaven. Think of the phenomenal things that would happen in the world if, as Christian believers, we would unite our efforts in prayer for certain issues. Think of what would happen if we would wrestle with God as a church, as a nation, as the body of Christ. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 16 says, "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help us in time of need." Think about how many of the bad laws and injustices would be turned around if we would only wrestle with God in prayer. Verses 24 through 28 says, "So he said to him, 'What is your name?' He said, 'Jacob.' And he said, 'Your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed.'" Prevailing prayer. Jacob was taught that he had to become a new man and change his behavior. And God changed Jacob's name to Israel. But why? What was God doing with Jacob? And the name Jacob meant supplanter, heel grabber, or deceiver. But the name represented what Jacob had been in the past. And his name was a symbol of his old nature, his old man. But now the old nature and old man had been changed. Jacob was no longer depending upon himself. He was trusting God to save and deliver him. He was trusting God to help him fulfill God's call and purpose for his life. And the name Israel means prevailer. It's the person who strives and fights with God and prevails, or else it means God strives, God rules, God prevails. This is the reason the name Israel is sometimes known as Prince of God, the person who prevails and rules under God. And Jacob and God both had wrestled with one another and both prevailed. Jacob was a new man. His nature had been changed by God, and he now knew that he was totally dependent upon God, and that without God, he was crippled, helpless, and powerless. Ephesians chapter 4 verses 22 through 24 says that you put off concerning your former conduct the old man which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. Jacob was a new man with a new life. Therefore, he must live a holy and pure life, a life totally dedicated and committed to God. And he must live like a new man. He must now trust God day by day, step by step. Thus, he needed a new name to help him remember, the name of Israel. Verse 29 says, "Then Jacob asked, saying, 'Tell me your name, I pray.' And he said, 'Why is it that you ask about my name?' And he blessed him there." Jacob had a spiritual prayer experience. Jacob asked God for more. Jacob asked God to confirm his deep experience even more by revealing his name, the very name of God himself. Jacob was as we have been when God was giving us a deep experience of himself. He didn't want to let go of God. He wanted more manifestations of God. He wanted God to show him more and more of himself. So he asked God to reveal his name. John chapter 14 verse 21 says, "He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him." God will manifest himself to those who love him and keep his commandments. But there comes a time when the prayer experience has to end. Besides, no man, not even Jacob, could ever bear more than the most minute revelation of God's presence and name, because God's glory would consume any of us. Thus God blessed Jacob and left him. Verses 30 to 32 says, "And Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, for I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved. Just as he crossed over Peniel, the sun rose on him, and he limped on his hip. Therefore, to this day, the children of Israel do not eat the muscle that shrank, which is on the hip socket, because he touched the socket of Jacob's hip and the muscle that shrank." The results of Jacob's prevailing prayer was that Jacob named the place Peniel, which means the face of God. And he was amazed that he was allowed to see the face of God and live. And Jacob was given two signs to commemorate his experience with God: a sunrise and his crippling. And the sun rose above him as he walked over Peniel, and he was limping because of his dislocated hip. Jacob would forever remember God's glorious encounter with him at Peniel, and the scar of God's great struggle with him was to be tolerated in his body for the rest of his life. But it was a welcome scar, because it was a reminder that he had to depend upon God step by step as he went forth to claim the great promises of God, both the promised land and the promised seed. Jacob became a testimony to others, and this experience of Jacob was considered to be so important that the nation of Israel adopted the practice of never eating hip muscle when eating meat. But it wasn't a practice that was demanded by God. It was just a practice that was instituted by the people. Think about how desperately we need Peniels in our lives, places where we can meet God face to face. How desperately we need to seek the face of God when we're in need. Zephaniah chapter 2 verse 3 says, "Seek the Lord, all you meek of the earth, who have upheld his justice. Seek righteousness, seek humility. It may be that you will be hidden in the day of the Lord's anger." How often would we be delivered through the great trials and problems of life if we would only seek the Lord's face? How often would we be saved and delivered from divorce and enslaving sins if only we would seek the Lord's face? How often would we be saved and delivered from broken friendships, ruptured business relationships, gnawing temptations and sickness and disease if only we would seek the face of God? Jacob's experience has been called the crippling that crowns, and the name Israel was interpreted to mean a God-mastered man. When God rules our lives, then he can trust us with his power, because only those who are under his authority have the right to exercise his authority. While at home, Jacob had served himself, and he created problems. And for 20 years, he served Laban, and he created further problems. But now he would serve God. And instead of being part of the problem, Jacob would become a part of the answer. Once again, Jacob gave a special name to a significant place. This time it was Peniel, which means the face of God. He thought that seeing God's face would bring death, but it actually brought him new life. It was the dawning of a new day for Israel, Jacob. He had a new name. He had a new walk. He was limping. And he had a new relationship with God that would help him face and solve any problem if he would only exercise faith. And the Bible shows us that a genuine encounter with God will profoundly change our identity. But it's only possible to find out who we are and develop a reliable self-image after we have had a personal encounter with God in prevailing prayer. So pray and keep on praying, and don't let go of God until he answers your prayer. Amen. Amen. Can we praise God for his word this morning? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.